All right, cool. Well, welcome everybody to Practical Dives with Oxen.ai. Today we're going to be extending what we did 2 weeks ago before the holidays, in building an end-to-end question answering system. 2 weeks ago, we looked at how you could use a Mamba model for the extraction part of question answering. And so today we're going to dive into extending that with Retrieve, with RAG, which stands for Retrieval Augmented Generation. We actually went over the research paper back in September for RAG. So if you're just wondering about the details of that paper or want a deeper dive into the math or the models themselves, we have that here. It was introduced by the Facebook AI research team back in 2020, but there's been a lot of progress between now and then in open source models and people extending RAG to their use cases. So those are the types of things that we're going to be diving into today. So to start off with, what are we building? I decided to split this one into a two-part series because it was just a lot to fit in this 45-minute time slot. And so what we're going to be building in this two-part series is an end-to-end question and answer system that fetches documents from a vector database and then uses these documents as context to answer a question. And we'll be using a lot of components along the way. We'll be using Oxen.ai to store the raw text, the pre-computed embeddings, as well as the results for all of the models. We'll be using this large language model that's called GTE Large. It's a text encoder, and this is going to be for encoding the documents into vectors that we can then go search. We're going to be using Modal, which is a serverless compute platform to compute all of the embeddings. I found this super useful for anybody that doesn't have a NVIDIA GPU just sitting right next to them at all times. I was able to do all of this on my MacBook Pro, and offloading the compute to Modal. It was actually super smooth and excited to show you how that works. We'll be using Chroma as the vector database to store all of these embeddings after we compute them. And then finally, we'll be using one of the newer models to come out, Mistral 7b, and specifically Mistral 7b Instruct version 2, as kind of the reasoning engine at the end of that pipeline. And so, with that all said, we'll kind of have an end-to-end example where we can take in a user's question, like, where was Beyonce's first child born? Which was a question from one of the data sets that we had. Beyonce happened to be at the top of this, so we're just going to be working with her all day. But the idea is our retrieval system will be able to pull back documents that talk about the topics that the person is querying for. And not every document within here is going to have the answer, but some of them are. So the job of our final model is going to be, once we've fetched all of these documents, read each one of them, figure out in this case which one talks about Beyonce's first child being born, and extract the correct answer of Lenox Hill Hospital, parentheses, New York. And you can see it even took it from this last paragraph and kind of like prettied it up and put the parentheses around it. It didn't just copy and paste it from there. So pretty cool. That's the end-to-end functionality that we'll have by the end of this. But I think it's good to first start with reiterating why we would want to do this RAG in the first place. Why are we doing retrieval and not just letting the large language model answer the question? Large language models have shown an impressive ability just to be able to store factual knowledge directly in their parameters. And when we say neural network parameters, we mean it's literally just a set of floats that looks like this, but there's a couple billion of them. So just a set of numbers. And the problem with this is, although they do store a lot of this knowledge in their parameters, they're typically static after you train them, just because the training is pretty expensive. For example, if you are familiar with this intro to large language models video from Andre Karpathy, he talks about how these models are really cool compression engines where they can take the entire internet, train them for 12 days, and it costs $2 million. And then eventually you have just this set of parameters that's like 140 gigabytes of numbers that represents the 10 terabytes of text. So that part's super expensive. People typically only do it once because it is so expensive. But the fact is, the world is not static, even if our model is, and information is updated constantly out on the web. So how do we incorporate this new knowledge without actually training a new model that's very expensive? And I like to think of it as like, imagine you took a snapshot of your brain when you were 16 years old. Now you're 21. You have a lot of real world knowledge from back then. You'd be able to navigate the world, but you wouldn't know who the current president is or who won the last Super Bowl. So that's kind of like how this RAG technique will help us retrieve information from a vector database, augment the knowledge that's already built into those parameters, and then spit out an answer that has some evidence to back it up. So before we dive into any of the code, I'd love to just like give some examples of why this is useful. So I built an end-to-end pipeline. All of this is on GitHub as well. And so first we're going to start with using the Mistral 7b instruct with no context and just poke around and ask some questions of it. Ben, can you verify that everyone can see my screen? Because I know sometimes I mess that up.
Yeah, we're looking at your terminal right now.
Okay, great. So in this case, I'm loading up the 7b model. I just put a little ask me anything, and we'll start with another Beyonce question. This one is just straight generating this response from the parameters. So where was Beyonce born? It says Houston. Within my prompt, I tried to tell it to answer the question with a single word, if possible. If you do not know the answer, say, I don't know. So that's kind of why it had this post set of text that said, I tried to do it with a single word, which is kind of funny that even though I asked it to, it had to explain itself. So it wasn't a single word. But if we extend this to another example that's not built into the parameters, said, where was Beyonce's first child born? If you remember from before, is actually the child was born in New York City, and it got confused and just thought that Beyonce's first child was born where Beyonce was. And so this is an example of a model hallucinating or just latching on to some part of the question and getting a little confused. It's trying to give some answer. It just has no backing for that. So that would be an example of a model hallucinating. If we go ahead and hook this up to our Chroma database of examples that we can go retrieve some knowledge and then answer a question, we can ask the same thing. Where was Beyonce's first child born? And in this case, you can see the first step, it computed some embeddings, it went and fetched some documents for supporting evidence. So actually the top document that it returned does have the answer right here, but it also did, I just told it to do the top three documents just in case. And now with the retrieval, the same model that got it wrong before looked up some information, got the right information, and answered New York at Lenox Hill Hospital. So that's pretty cool. That's kind of like the end-to-end what we'll be building. I thought it would be fun to even add some examples that aren't in Wikipedia to show how we can extend it even beyond there. So I did, for example, who's the CEO of Oxen.ai? This isn't in the dump of Wikipedia that we put in there. It said, I don't know, Oxen.ai is not mentioned in the provided context. And I simply added a few more documents to this database. Actually, I added three new documents with a total of 23,000 in there. One of them mentioning me, the company, Oxen.ai, and some other facts about me. And just simply adding those three new documents, it was able to bubble up that those facts to the top. And instead of saying, I don't know, answer something about myself or answer something about Oxen. What does Oxen.ai provide? A Git-like interface for machine learning data. What activities does Greg enjoy? Again, it's just reading these from whatever documents we put in, hiking, skiing, camping, and cleaning data, which I love. So.
Greg, I had a question in the chat from Zach. When using RAG, does that also have the side effect of making a model more likely to reply with, I don't know?
That's a good question. The I don't know part was just built into the prompt that I gave it. And that's just a difficult problem in general, is like, how do you get a model to know when it doesn't know? And it's an active area of research, but honestly is a little separate from RAG, and it's more about how you could get the model to understand that it doesn't have enough of context to provide. So I think that more came from the Mistral 7B instruct data set than RAG, the way that this model was trained. If that makes sense.
And then Ray also had a question around the GitHub repo to follow along with the code. Is that published or in the Notion somewhere?
Yes, it is in the Notion. I will bump it to the top. It's down, if you scroll down to modal GTT embeddings, all the scripts that I'll be running are in there. But I will also put it way at the top so that everybody can have it. Cool. Anything else in there, Ben? All right. So, how do we build a system like the one that I just demoed from all open source components? If you are familiar with RAG, I would like to make the disclaimer that we're building a RAG-like system and not reproducing the full paper itself. RAG is, or the one that Facebook presented, is an end-to-end system where they train both a query encoder and a generator jointly. So it's kind of like one model end to end that can do all of this. What's cool with a lot of the open source technologies that have come out is we can start to mix and match these things and build our own systems out of the subcomponents. So I'm really going to dive into, okay, what component are we going to use for encoding documents? What component are we going to use for retrieving documents given a question? And then what models can we use to generate an answer given a question and the context? So those are kind of the three things that we can think about swapping out as we go. And I made a nice little diagram of what this might look like end to end. So say we had the question come in, who won Super Bowl 50? The first step is you need some sort of encoder, LLM, to take this question and turn it into a vector representation that's just going to look like a bunch of floating point numbers. I did a little digging on Hugging Face. There's a couple that people seem to be liking, including this NLP or GTE large, which is the one that we'll be using. If we go to huggingface.co and just search for GTE large, anybody can go and grab this. It's a general, GTE stands for General Text Embeddings. and they have a research paper to go along with it. The idea is you have a source sentence, you have sentences to compare them to, and then you can just purely compute a similarity between them with this model. So in this case, they're saying that is a happy person is closest to that is a happy dog versus today is a sunny day. But if you look here, there's like a whole list of other models that we could potentially swap in. They claim that they have their best accuracy, so that's why I'm using it for here. But that's kind of the first step in the pipeline, is trying to choose an encoder LLM. What you'll do with that encoder LLM is you'll take a raw corpus of data, you'll pump every paragraph or sentence, you kind of have to chunk it up in some way, but you'll pump that through your encoder LLM and you'll get out a set of vectors, which we'll show you what that looks like. You'll then put those vectors plus the documents that they go with into a document index. Some people call this a vector database. We're going to be using Chroma today, but there's ones called QGrant or Pinecone. These are very swappable components, and some might have better performance in terms of querying with metadata versus some might be faster to run on the GPU. You just kind of have to look into what's going to suit your need. Once you have those two components, you can then take the question, encode it with the encoder LLM, which is the same LLM that you used to encode all of the documents, do a similarity search, and that's going to re-rank all of the documents for which one are closest in the embedding space to your question. And now we're going to have a rank list of supporting evidence or documents that could potentially answer the question. And we can use a final, I'm just calling it generator LLM, that can read each one of those pieces of supporting evidence and try to extract the right answer. So the main takeaway here is you don't actually have to have the same encoder as generator. And I think there's a lot of room to play with how do we make the best model for encoding versus how do we make the best model for just like reasoning on top of it or collating all that information to get the right answer. So in this case, we'll be using Mistral 7B, but you could use Llama 2, or you could use the Mamba series that we did a few weeks ago, even though we saw the performance was a little lower there. Just kind of want to give you the lay of the land of where you can play within this architecture. So the first thing we're going to do is find a corpus of texts or facts that we want to be able to answer questions about. You could imagine sample corpora being all of Wikipedia, or maybe legal documents, internal company documents, a chat history. Maybe you export all of your Slack and you want to be able to ask questions about the company history. These would be all great use cases for putting them into a document vector database, searching over them, and having an LLM process them. In this case, we want something with some concrete right and wrong answers. So we're going to be using the Squad Stanford question answering dataset again. This is the same one we used a couple weeks ago with Mamba. The format of this is a question, a context that has the answer, and then the answer. But as we kind of go through this data, we're going to split it into kind of two tasks or two data sets that are going to help us evaluate different portions of this whole pipeline here. There's kind of the retrieval half of the pipeline of how well can we even find relevant documents. And then there's the generator half of, given we found relevant documents, can we extract the answer? And it's really nice to be able to split out those two components and really start to optimize the retriever half versus optimize the generator half separately. So what I did was I took this data set. You can find all the data on Oxen.ai. And if we just look at the training data here, you'll notice that it has question, context, and answers. And every single one of these, again, this is why we kind of started with Beyonce, they actually, within this data set, they took like the first paragraph of Wikipedia, the second paragraph, the third, and then they had grad students ask questions about each one of those. So this context is actually repeated over and over and over again. So each one of these questions are all about the same passage. So what I did was I took this data set and I split it into a new one. You'll see that there's like 131,000 question context answer pairs in the original data set. But if you collapse that down into unique contexts and then put the question IDs next to it, we've kind of transformed this into, okay, this is a unique context passage, and these are all the question IDs that were asked about that. So now we have a unique set of about 20,000 examples that we're going to index into our vector database. Again, you can kind of see how this is the Wikipedia page for Beyonce, but now we only have one example of each paragraph, and there are, I don't know how many unique Wikipedia pages there are, but there's a lot of different topics within here.
We had two great questions in the chat from Alex, both kind of about context. The first was around how when the RAG retrieved relevant documents take up tokens in this context, right? They're basically appended to the search query that's getting passed into the generator, which I think is a yes.
Yep. Yeah. So what we do with the documents after we fetch them is we'll take a prompt that kind of looks like this. And so that's my query without context. And we pretty much just append what we found. And you can have the prompt be whatever you want, but I'm simply putting all of those paragraphs within this string. And I say, this is the context, this is the question, and then they have to fill in the answer, the LLM.
Great. And so then further from there, to kind of avoid eating up progressively more and more of context in these back and forth chat worlds with RAG, are there any approaches that try to minimize that? Alex mentioned recursive approaches, but anything else you know of?
I have seen just like trying to summarize that information into a smaller context window, but that is a big thing that we'll run into even later within this dive, is like I did some experiments retrieving one document or retrieving 3 or 5 or 10, or I went all the way up to 100. And when I got to those bigger sizes, I couldn't even fit the entire forward pass on the GPU. I just like ran out of memory. So it is a kind of problem that's biting people today, and I think a super interesting area of research. Does that make sense? Cool. Good questions. So now that we have all of the unique contexts, and we have about 20,000, 19,000 of them, I also split out the questions themselves into a data set that's just question ID, question, and the answer. So just a little cleaner view of that. And now that we have these data sets, which you can just grab the processed ones that I made directly from Oxen, what we can do is use modal and use our general text embedding model to compute these embeddings. So again, in the GitHub, we have this example right here. It's called embeddings.py. What's really cool is we can pick the type of GPUs that we're going to want to run this model on. At the top of the script, you can set whatever encoder model you want, some other parameters. I decided to use 10 GPUs because that's kind of like on the lower tier of what you can do on modal, but honestly, it cranked through them ridiculously fast. And then this whole script is about 200 lines, and it does everything from spinning up this text embedding server, inference server, which will be listening on port 8000 for us to be firing text over to it. It embeds that text, and then what we do is once that server's up and running, we have this embed dataset function that will download the data from Oxen, iterate over, connect to that text embeddings inference server, generate a bunch of batches that we're going to want to compute, compute the embeddings for them, and then save all of that to a Parquet file that we're just going to pump right back into Oxen. And that entire process for all 20,000 examples, all 20,000 contexts, took about 90 seconds for me, just straight up from my MacBook. And it was just these two simple commands, one to set up the embedding server and one to compute the embeddings. And all of that cost about $2 for 90 seconds of compute, plus all of the debugging that I did along the way where it wasn't working properly. So if you got it right the first time, it might be like 50 cents for all of that, which is pretty awesome. And I went ahead and just put all of those embeddings right back into this Oxen repository. It's kind of that same format of the context here, the question IDs of the questions that were asked about that context, and then the raw embeddings here, which are hard to visualize because they're 1,024 floats, but you can kind of get a sense of what an actual embedding looks like in the UI here. But we're not going to actually do much with that, except anybody can come download this Parquet file, put it into your own vector database if you want. I think it's kind of nice to have this step in between to, one, version the embeddings that you have, and two, have a distribution platform to get them to your researchers or other teams that'll be working on them. Because you could imagine generating the same embeddings.parquet file with any of the models listed here, or as soon as a new model comes out that could be better, you might want to like have the same context, but just swap out everything in this column and run the same experiment. So that's kind of why I've separated them out here, as well as just to give you guys access to it so that you don't have to run the compute yourself. And so we kind of went over the GTE embeddings already. I think it would be interesting to do a dive into this paper in general, but if you came to the Clip dive just from reading the abstract, it sounds very similar to Clip, where Clip, they're trying to embed images and text into the same embedding space. Here, they're trying to embed text and text into the same embedding space. Because if you think of like a question and a paragraph, obviously paragraphs that look similar are going to cluster together, but how do you get a question and a paragraph pair to cluster together, even though they're not going to have the exact same structure as like two paragraphs would? So that's kind of what the GTE model does. So assuming you have all of that pre-computed, it's pretty easy to grab Chroma off the shelf. They have a Python library that you can just pip install. You can create a local database just directly on your computer. Be careful to use the persistent client, because the first time I did this, I just used their client and it didn't save anything to disk. This one will save it to disk in this directory. You can create a collection. I just called it squad embeddings, and then basically take that Parquet file that I generated, iterate over all the rows. They have a few fields within their add function. So this is a pretty standard CRUD for vector databases, where you're going to insert the embedding, you're going to insert documents, which is just the raw text. So in our case, the context column. And then they also let you put in metadata. I noticed that Chroma was a little limited on the metadata that you could put in. They only allowed you to put in like key value pairs that didn't have any nested lists. So that's why I concatenated all of these question IDs into a string, a comma separated string, and put that in as my metadata. And then they ask you for an ID for each document. So I just use the row index here. But if you had a document ID in some other database and still wanted to leverage the embedding search, that's kind of what you would put in there. So pretty straightforward to create a vector database from a set of vectors. And again, I'm adding the metadata of the question IDs so that when we retrieve the documents, given a question, we can see if that pair was something that we were looking for or not, just in the case of this experiment. So now that we have everything indexed into Chroma, we can query the embeddings, which is also pretty straightforward and a small amount of code. So just boilerplate connecting to your database. I put this into a while loop that you can play with, where we have this function to compute the embedding given text. For brevity, I didn't put it in here, but I just grabbed it straight from the GTE large example here. It's also a pretty short function just to like grab the embedding, get it given any text. You then take that embedding and you pass it to the collection query method. So instead of like your traditional search engine where you're putting text into here, you're putting just the computed embedding into the query function, and it's going to return all of the documents and the metadatas that we asked for. The reason that it's plural is you can actually do multiple at once if you wanted to. So like in this example, you could put in four queries and get back four different result sets. In this case, we're just doing one embedding and just taking the first one here. And then for that, you can say how many results do you want to get back? In this case, we're saying 10. So the top 10 nearest documents given the question. And I'm just printing them out here for debug. And this is all well and good, but we kind of want to evaluate the retrieval more than just eyeballing. And honestly, if you run that and you see the big block of like four paragraphs or 10 paragraphs spit out because you did end results equals 10, it takes me a long time to even read through there and be like, is the answer in here? I don't know. It's a lot of reading. So that was the reason that I kept the question IDs with it, so that for each one of those top documents, given a question, we can say, was this the context that answered the question? And in a real world scenario, you're actually not even guaranteed, or in most scenarios, you're not guaranteed that the top document retrieved is the one that contains the right answer. In fact, it might not even be in the top three or the top 10 or top 100. Information retrieval is like a long study problem on its own, and we can't expect just a straight embedding cosine similarity to fix this every time. But I thought it would be interesting to look at what is the recall of, if we just look at the top document, if we look at the top three, if we look at the top 10, what's the threshold that we start seeing the correct answer showing up the most? So within that script, or within that GitHub repo, I have this compute recall script, and I ran it on this data set with a bunch of different ends. And I thought it was super interesting. The GTE model, right out of the gate, if you just say, I only want to retrieve one document, is the answer in that top document? It is 63% of the time, which is ridiculously high for like a top one. And then I did top three, that bumps it all the way up to 78. Top five gets it up to 82. And then top 100, the right answer is somewhere within those top 100 documents, 97% of the time. So that's pretty awesome. That's like a really high recall for a question answering system. Now the problem is we have to take all 100 of those documents and find the right answer in there. So back to the question that we had earlier, 100 paragraphs is actually a pretty large context window. And for the second half of this, which we'll dive into next week, we'll look at some of these result sets. And I was actually only able to run experiments up to the context length of 10 paragraphs. Otherwise, I just ran out of GPU memory. But that still gives you a pretty high recall of 86% of the time the right answer is in there. But it gets back to that issue of, okay, for that other 14 or 13%, how do we know to say, I don't know if the answer isn't actually in there? So that's kind of what we'll dive into in the next time. But this is like a really, really encouraging first step that we can find the right answer 97% of the time with this GTE embeddings. I would love for people to take this code, and I listed a few other models up here, but like, let's try the E5 large 2, or let's try the BGE small, and see if they get comparable results. Maybe they get better top one, maybe they don't, I don't know, but that's the type of experimentation that I think would be really easy to do and fun to kind of look at, like, can we build a better encoder half of this thing while keeping the generator the same, etc.
Wanted to just point everybody towards Zach's comment in the chat in case it got buried by anything. Was talking about some strategies for more efficient use of whatever context window you do have available, given these RAG messages, and making sure that as you're accumulating them, you know, not to just keep every past RAG lookup, but to filter only the ones that you're newly adding. So I thought that was great.
Nice. Yeah. If anybody has other techniques there, toss it in the chat. Be super interesting. So next up, like I said, we know the answer is hidden somewhere within those first 100 documents. You also don't have to, like we just talked about, you don't have to have all 100 in there always. So just the fact that I couldn't fit everything in on one pass doesn't mean we couldn't iteratively go through and look for the answer within those 100 documents. We will be looking at Mistral 7B or other models if we have more time to extract the answer from it. And it's great to look at recall, but we're really curious in like, what's the overall accuracy of the model? And then maybe what's the precision of the model given that we do have the right answer? And just like a little sneak preview, Mistral's precision is anywhere between 65 and 72 when I was looking at that. And so that, when I was looking at the Mistral 7B instruct model, and that stayed pretty consistent with the recall ranging from 60% in the top one to 97% in the top 100. So if you think about that, just bumping up the recall is inherently going to bump up the accuracy if the precision stays the same. But we'll look at some actual numbers there next time. Precision will help us answer how well did we answer the question given that we had the correct answer within the context? And if you want a sneak peek at that code, all the code is actually already up on the GitHub there. I didn't think we had enough time in the 45 minutes to go through both the retrieval half and the generation half. And there is a lot of code to walk through there, but it is pretty isolated into here's where you index, here's where you search, here's where you generate given the search. And I would love to like have these be Lego blocks that we can all play with and try to make the best end-to-end RAG system we can. So with that, if there's any other questions I missed or just general chatter, I would love to hear your guys' thoughts.
And Tom, context windows are increasing, so that's becoming less of a challenge as it was a year ago. Recall is still the biggest challenge for RAG, in my opinion.
Yeah, I'm curious. I don't know if you want to hop on, Tom, but have you done some like real world experiments with RAG? Because I know the Wikipedia question answering data set is great, but it's kind of like a trivia QA thing. And I think it would be really interesting to run RAG on, like I said, Slack history or legal documents. Feel free to answer in the chat if you don't want to hop on.
All good, in bed with the cold.
Anton said, what do we lose when we deviate from the strict RAG approach of jointly training the encoder generator instead of using separate models like is commonly done and like we just did in this demo? I think the main thing that you lose when you do the jointly end-to-end trained approach is that joint encoder and or generator and query encoder inherently starts to put the documents and the questions into the same embedding space as the task at hand. And so that's kind of what the GTE model was trying to generically do across a bunch of different tasks. But if you have a specific task in a specific data set, I think the end-to-end jointly trained approach is always going to do better than these generic approaches. That's kind of my take.
I was seeing some stuff. Zach had a great note in the chat as well that says he would still caution against unnecessarily using your context window. He's seen results that suggest that GPT-4 Turbo's performance starts degrading around 70K tokens, and also points out that it'll be more expensive. I saw some stuff where people were analyzing kind of, you know, really pushing the limits of the context window and then burying, you know, the important relevant nugget of information somewhere in the middle. And I also saw that it was performing way better if it was listed at the beginning or if it was at the end. But it was starting to kind of, yes, it has access to all of that context, but may preferentially view certain and pull from certain portions of it.
Yeah, the more you overwhelm it and flood it with information, the harder it's going to be to find that needle in a haystack. So that totally makes sense. And also, the more tokens you consume, the more money you'll spend on API calls. So yeah, what Ben just described is almost certainly the same thing I was thinking of. Cool. All right. Well, Scott, do you want to stop the recording here and maybe we can do a little offline chatter?